Dearest Gail, since receiving that horrible VHS tape sent to us by Donald Trump, the men and I have been vigorously investigating the situation with Melania at the White House. Our main problem was that finding a way into the White House undetected was nearly impossible. We knew all staff and security was working for Melania, and our dear Donald was as good as cummed and cheetoed if we blew our cover in any way. Matthew sighed. I'm just so worried about Gail. Melania is a very vain and jealous woman. If she left the leader of the free world sobbing in a puddle of cum and Cheetos, what would she do to our Gail? I still think using a mole is our best bet, Hugh said, pounding his fist into his palm. But we know Melania uses emotional read scanners at the door, I reminded him. If those scanners detect vastness, she'll immediately know it was one of our men. We don't have anyone that would qualify as a spy from Church of Gale, Hugh persisted. Someone who doesn't meet the standards to be on Gale's marriage list and who looks like they'd belong in government. I scratched my chin, thinking about this more carefully. Just then, one of our utility retards entered the room with a mop and bucket and began cleaning the corner of the room. I watched as he took a break to pick his nose and in the process knocked his glasses off his face and into the mop bucket. The retard bent to go fish his glasses out of the dirty water and slipped, landing head first into the bucket and turning the whole thing over with a sloppy crash. He laid there face down in a pile of dirty mop water on the floor. I'm okay, his muffled voice crooned retardedly. That was when I jumped up from my chair. I just had a brilliant idea, I exclaimed. The men's eyes all widened in unison. We'll send a retard. Brilliant, Brent, Matthew agreed with enthusiasm. The White House is swarming with retards. They wouldn't notice if another one showed up, much less show any suspicion. I went over to the retard on the floor and picked him up. Okay, tard soldier, I think we have an important job for you, I proudly informed him. The retard looked up at me with blankness and confusion. Hi, Master Brent. I already spit-shined the urinals. Also, I licked all the light sockets. And they're all still working. I think I pooped my pants a little, though. Good, I praised him. Let's get you cleaned up. You're coming with us. The men and I quickly got to work preparing our retard for action. After briefing him on the mission at hand, we equipped him with several tiny spy cameras. Within the next couple hours, we all piled into a white van and dropped the retard off several blocks from the White House. Here you go, laddie, Gerard said, handing the retard a packet of Nilla wafer cookies and a high-C juice box. The retard beamed, my favorite! We all smiled and waved at the retard and then quickly sped off to a safer location to park our vehicle. Back in the white van, it was time to strap ourselves into the camera monitors and watch our retard get to work. Live on the retard camera feed, we watched as the retard shoveled down the block, sipping from his high-C juice box until he eventually made it to the White House lawn. There he smiled and sprawled down onto the grass, staring up at the sun. This is it, I thought out loud. Now we wait. As expected, the retard was soon spotted by White House security. Black-suited security guards emerged to collect the retard. He turned toward them as they approached, and a big grin lit up on his face. Hi, the retard gurgled to them happily. I pooped my pants once. The black security guard sighed. I ain't signed up for the Secret Service to babysit no retardits. His white colleague looked at him. Would you rather go back to protection duty for Michelle Obama? The black guard shuddered. And trying not to look at the tent she be pitching every time Obama gives a speech? Sheet! That bitch's dick is bigger than mine. Creeps me the hell out. Anyway, the white guard said, is this retard one of ours? What department are we missing retards from? The guards began to check the retard over. The men and I lurched forward in our seats as we watched. No barcode, the black guard noted. I held my breath. Beside me in the van, Matthew grabbed my hand. After a long pause that seemed like hours, the black guard finally shrugged. Well, a free retard is a free retard. Ain't gonna complain. Let's just send him to the lab, the white guard suggested. Melania needs all the supplies she can get down there. Good idea. The men and I sighed heavily with relief. Matthew squeezed my hand with excitement, while Hugh and Gerard fist bumped. The retard was led by the hand into the White House and shoved inside an elevator. One of the suited men pressed the down button outside the elevator, and the retard descended. When the doors opened once again, my eyes widened. "Aye, laddies," Gerard murmured from beside me. "That old bitch Melania has been mighty busy." Our retard had arrived at what appeared to be an underground facility buried deep beneath the White House. Long white lab tables stretched from end to end in the vast pale room. An army of goggled scientists in lab coats were studiously working at the tables. Retards in gray custodial uniforms hobbled about mopping and sweeping, some collecting trash from the lab tables. Several of them crooned retard noises, while others picked their noses, playing with small objects they had found, or simply stared off into space. As our retard arrived, he was handed a gray uniform and a mop, and pushed toward the middle of the room to begin working. Melania, flaunting a blood-red dress, surveyed her great laboratory like a hawk, stalking slowly around the facility in hungry anticipation of results. Her red high heels ticked devilishly against the floor, and her long red dress swayed behind her. Her face was like black ice. "Soon," she hissed, "soon I will know what makes Gail the most beautiful woman in the world." On the lab tables lay countless copies of Empress Gail's nude Playboy photos. Several scientists furiously masturbated to the photos, taking notes after each ejaculation. Each of the scientists wore clear plastic tarps as well as thick lab goggles to protect their eyes from the blitzkrieg of semen blasting all over the area. A caution wet floor sign was erected at the center of the station, warning fellow workers entering the hazardous zone. In addition to the photos, videos of Gail played on various laptops scattered about the tables. Some of the videos were from Gail's YouTube channel, explaining her diet, exercise, and beauty routines. One video was of Gail bleaching her mustache while reading the Bible. Yet another video was one of Gail attempting to use the custom dildo we sent her as a Christmas present one year. She created the video to share with her men as a gift of intimacy before the Jesuits later stole the video and tried to present it as vulgar. In the video, Gail spread her magnificent legs and looked into the camera, wearing nothing but a blue turtleneck sweater and talking the entire time. Gail thoughtfully made adjustments to the camera in an effort to produce the highest quality video for her men, ultimately failing to accommodate the dildo before concluding that penetration required a man's force. The scientist watching this video ejaculated so hard he fell and passed out onto the slippery floor next to the wet floor sign, but his colleagues were too invested into their work to notice. Suddenly, one scientist in the middle of the room shot up from his desk. "I have it," he shouted. "I have discovered why Gail is the most beautiful woman in the world." Melania's eyes widened. "What?" she exclaimed. "What is it? I must know this instant." A light flashed from behind her on the wall as a projector flashed to life. On screen was a picture of one of Gail's first nude Playboy photos, complete with Pepe faces censoring her genitalia. "It's so simple," the scientist explained. "Gail's genetic profile. She's 50% King David. No woman in the world could compete with the woman after God's own heart." "Ridiculous," Melania shouted. "You are telling me it is not possible to compete with Gail?" "Well," the scientist continued, "after many tests and careful masturbating, we were able to determine the part of Gail's body that contains the most concentrated levels of DNA from King David." "And that is?" Melania frowned, her arms crossed, tapping her fingers impatiently. "Why, it's the part of Gail's body that the Jesuits have been attacking from the very beginning. The crown of Gail's ripened femininity, unscathed by scissors, unadulterated from the shearing of razors, untouched, unkempt, unfettered for over 60 years, the flower which grows on an eternally blooming vine that is sweetened like fine wine." "Where?" Melania snapped. She whipped around to view the nude photo of Gail on the projector, eyeing it scrutinously. "Well," the scientist replied, "that would be in the..." Melania gasped. She approached the screen with awe-stricken wonder as her hand glided over Gale's fully endowed pubic mound. She finished the scientist's sentence for him. "Indie pubes," she hissed. Melania's red-painted nails then curled like claws, and she spun around to face the lab. "I demand a pube tope of Gale's pubes, a divine pube pay. It is as the crown of Miss Universe, wrongfully placed on the inferior woman Gale, when it should belong to I, Melania Trump." Yes, the scientist bowed his head in submission. "Of course, we will get you your Gale pube pay. The question is, how do we steal Gale's pubes when she is protected by Jesus and the men and her Gale shield?" "That's easy," Melania cawed. "I will present an ultimatum to Gale, warning her that if she does not comply with my demands for her pubes, I will kill Donald Trump and officially take his place as United States president." Melania then flailed her head back like a snake and began to cackle, her hands curling into claws with glee. The men and I looked at each other with pale gazes. We knew immediately that we would protect our Gale and her pubes at all cost, as well as U.S. President Donald Trump. But how? "Aye, lads, it's time to get to the drawing room. Looks like we've got a real bitch in our hands," Gerard said. With solidarity and determination, we all nodded. Firing up the white van, we drove back to Church of Gale to deliberate on our plan of action. Your husband, Brent Spiner. Okay, everybody, you just heard Melania's, what she's doing and the ultimatum she's laid down. And I would just appreciate prayer. I would like the world to pray for Donald Trump and for me to help me to make the right decision. From what I understand, her military is superior to ours. All that money that Donald Trump's been spending on the Space Force and everything, that's all been Melania. And she spent trillions to build herself the most powerful military in the world. So that's what we're up against. So I would just appreciate prayer. And I know some of you all have given me some good suggestions. You know, in the past, like when I talked about my financial problems and stuff, so I welcome any comments underneath the video. I will be reading them and I'm going to be praying and I will make my decision tomorrow. So I'll be making a video tomorrow to let you know what I've decided. And we need to pray for Donald Trump and pray for me and my men and just ask God to make us very wise. Thank you very much.